To everyone here, to everyone online, welcome. My name is Mike Kinman. I'm the rector here at All Saints Church. My pronouns are he, him. It is wonderful to have everyone here today. If you are new or are visiting with us this morning, we would love to know who you are and keep you up to date on some future events at All Saints Church. And there is a green welcome sheet. There's contact sheets by the door. You can sign those. We always put our faith into action here at All Saints Church. And every week we pick one action to take on as a community. This Sunday we're asking you to sign a letter to your members of Congress asking them to stop the misuse of national park resources and personnel by the current administration. The current administration has been using park rangers and other law enforcement from parks across the nation for border enforcement. This puts our national park personnel into a position for which they are not trained. It leaves public lands across the country, which are already struggling due to increased visitor rates and decreasing funding, short-staffed. It is a misuse of our government employees. So we're asking that you go to the action table and sign a letter to your member of Congress asking the Trump administration to stop this misappropriation of public resources. We are grateful for your generosity, which along with everything that you bring to All Saints and the presence of the Holy Spirit here makes everything that we do possible. If you have made your pledge to All Saints for 2020, thank you so much. We still have a whole bunch of people who have not. If you need to get a pledge card, you can see me, you can see Terry Knowles. We can get that to you if you're online, or just go, like, if you're streaming right now and like to make a gift to All Saints, just click on that donate button that's right below me right now. And of course, at any time, you can go to allsaints-pas.org and you can make either a one-time gift or you can pledge to All Saints Church. I'm someone who really appreciates cool titles. And I went to the website of our guest this morning, and it described him as a violinist and social justice advocate, which I think is a really cool combination of a title. We are thrilled to have Vijay Gupta with us here today at All Saints Church, particularly because this is a busy week for you. You're known for a lot of things, but probably most for founding Street Symphony. It's almost 10 years ago now. Which is an amazing nonprofit that provides musical engagement, dialogue, and teaching artistry for people who are homeless and incarcerated and living in those communities. He is recently the recipient of a MacArthur Foundation Genius Grant, which I look at that and think, no pressure. And so I'm just going to turn it over to you to start this in your own unique way.
Thank you. I just want to sit here for a second. As I was getting ready for this conversation, I watched the TED talk that you did. And you talked about the struggle you had, should I go into music or medicine? And you told the story of Gabby Giffords and her recovery from her wound and how she was able to sing when she couldn't talk. And when you were playing, I could feel, I don't know if I really could, but it felt like it, I could feel a different part of my brain opening up. And this is the power of music, and I realize how infrequently the things I'm held accountable for and the things that I'm asked to do tend to use that part of me. So first of all, thank you for that gift.
Thank you very much.
I was listening this week to presidential candidate Andrew Yang. He was being interviewed by David Axelrod, and he said something that really caught my eye and related to a lot of what you do. He said, we have confused economic value with human value. And I've been thinking about that, and I've realized how much that is true. And when we do that, people become replaceable and disposable. And so I'm wondering if you could introduce us to the whole idea of street symphony through that lens of how we've confused economic value with human value.
Certainly. Well, firstly, good morning. And in my culture, we say namaste, namaskar. And the piece I've just played for you is a piece which very few audiences have heard yet. It's a piece written by an incredible composer named Rina Esmail, who also happens to be the woman I love. And she wrote this piece for me in a time of great grief for both of us. And the piece is called Darshan. And Darshan in Sanskrit or Hindi means vision, to see. But it has a double meaning that when we visit a temple or a holy place, we wish to have a darshan, a vision of the divine. And so in this room, in this space, in every space, we behold each other as divine. And that is the meaning of namaskar. And I actually feel that the best way to kind of begin this conversation is to say a couple of words I wrote this morning, which are from the great teacher Parker Palmer, who wrote a book called A Hidden Wholeness. And Parker Palmer was a student and kind of disciple of the great mystic Thomas Merton, who said, we are not but a collection of broken bones. And so I'd just like to read a couple of words of Parker's here. Not knowing who or what we are dealing with and feeling unsafe, we hunker down in a psychological foxhole and withhold the investment of our energy, commitment, and gifts. The perceived incongruity of inner and outer, the inauthenticity that we sense in others, or they in us, constantly undermines our morale, our relationships, and our capacity for good work. We are cursed with the blessing of consciousness and choice, a two-edged sword that both divides us and can help us become whole. The divided life may be endemic, but wholeness is always a choice. And he then goes on to say, you know, and describe pathways towards our wholeness, and that pathways towards wholeness are instances which create spaces between us where the soul feels safe enough to show up and make its claim on our lives. Feels safe enough to show up and make its claim on our lives. And for me, and for the over 90 or so musicians who are part of Street Symphony, music is our soul food. Music is our soul safety. and is a pathway not only towards serving those who we might call and regard as the least among us, but truly a pathway to our own wholeness. I think in the last nearly 10 years of street symphony, I've kind of given myself both maybe all of the following, you know, masters in public health and an MBA and learning how to manage a staff and write a budget and all the stuff that I never thought I'd be doing as a conservatory student in music. And it's been a very real human education to me because I have learned that we ostracize and marginalize and often criminalize the most fragile and vulnerable members of our society. And I believe we do it because we have, in our own way, shut ourselves off from the most fragile and vulnerable parts of ourselves. And this is why I believe we need the arts now more than ever as a public health intervention.
Amen.
And as a mental health intervention, and as a way for our souls to catch up with and claim our lives. Not the other way around. Not for our lives to claim something, but our souls to claim us. Because if we think about the soul as a collective, then we actually have room to be claimed. And so Street Symphony is designed to ask the question of who and how do we claim ourselves and our neighbors? And in the last 8 years or so, Street Symphony has become this experiment in how musicians who are often trained in incredibly elite settings, who have the gift of performing on some of the most prestigious concert hall stages in the world, can take the sacred work that we do in the concert hall and extend that sanctity into the spaces that we walk into. How do we sanctify a room with the music that we get to make and the music that gets to make us?
Wow, we could go like 15 different directions from there. That's great. Wow. So I love the language of music as a public health, a mental health intervention. You know, the last 3 years in this country, something has happened that has not happened in about 100 years, which is the average life expectancy has gone down for three straight years. And I wonder if that doesn't speak to, and of course, life expectancy here, it's tied to your zip code, it's tied to your ability to produce economically. So there's real, not just, I mean, there's huge quality of life impact, but there's also length of life impact to what we're talking about here. A piece in the quote that you talked about, how we hunker down in a psychological foxhole. I love that language. And so if economic value equals human value, then our value is something that can be lost. And therefore, it's something that we're afraid of. And you know, what's interesting is the people among whom, with whom you work, are people that those of us who are not in those populations are often taught to fear, either by, oh, these are people who will harm us, or maybe somehow by association, that lack of value will rub off on us. Can you just speak of the community that you have found, how it has changed and is changing you, how it's shifting your definitions of value?
And this, I believe, is truly the question that we get to ask when we shed the veneer of externally imposed valuing. Mm-hmm. You know, Parker Palmer also talks about the moral exoskeleton, as in that when we impose moral values externally, external to internal, that's a veneer that we can often take off, you know, but it turns into this kind of calcified armor that we walk around with. Mm-hmm. As a musician, I think about the metaphor of the fourth wall. And there was an experience very early on at Street Symphony where I sort of didn't tell my colleagues in the LA Philharmonic that we were going to go to Skid Row and play in a shelter. And I instead bribed them with beer and sandwiches, which is a thing that every musician loves. And so we went down to the Department of Mental Health Clinic in Skid Row, and we started playing a program of Beethoven string quartets and some Christmas carols, and we're kind of like gonna wipe our hands clean for having done our good charity work for the year. And somebody in the audience raised her hand in the middle of the Beethoven first movement, and she kept her hand in the air, throwing concert hall decorum to the wind. And us musicians went, whoa, 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 I did not sign up for human contact. Right? Because we are so used to operating behind that veneer, that calcified fourth wall, the armor of our tuxedo tails and the bright lights. And yet what we ache for is exactly that kind of connection with an audience, because when she had her hand called on and answered, she didn't ask a question. She kind of went on and told this long, sometimes rambling story. But what she talked about is how in the violence of the music that she heard her parents fighting at home. Mm. And how in the tender moments she heard her mom tucking her sister and herself into bed and making them feel safe after hearing arguments for the entire day. And so she put herself in the music, because there wasn't a fourth wall. And that, I believe, is what our audiences, our community, our teachers, our gurus in Skid Row and in county jails and clinics and shelters and prisons teach us, that this work, although it may begin from a place of charity or outreach, truly moves into a more mutual space of what we are now calling engagement. But what I think is most authentically stated as exchange, a place of interchange, a place of the creation of culture. You know, the word culture, C-U-L, the root, is the same root in the word collaborate and cultivate. And so culture is what we create together, you know, whether or not we are conscious of how we create it together. So if we choose, again, the choice to be conscious, what we are creating, hopefully, is a pathway towards a more restorative culture, where we are not coming in as the experts, and they are not the other. Mm-hmm. You know, we're often taught by people, our friends in recovery, who says there is no us and them. There is no us and them, right? And that part of the journey of recovery is as much the instances of recovery as much as they are the instances of relapse. You know, relapse is part of recovery. And, you know, I think that another thing that we've been taught is that we are never as great as our greatest moments, and we are never as cursed as our worst. And that is an important thing for us to remember, because often in this work, I believe that we have somehow fetishized the redemption story, mm-hmm. and that often in the instance of encountering addiction or homelessness or incarceration, the redemption story is a calcified myth, right? The myth that someone will get off the streets and enter into the white American dream of the picket fence and middle class life is an utter construct, right? And so when we say out of sight, out of mind, by building housing and not addressing serious community health issues, I think we're actually more on the lines of expiating our guilt than actually causing real change. And so I'll kind of pause there, because I'm starting to feel the soapbox kind of.
No, but this is, hey, well, you're in a church, you can preach, it's okay. Is this a good time to, you want to sure. show us, tell
sure,
us a little bit
sure,
of the story
sure.
and show us the video?
Absolutely. So one of the things that we enjoy at Street Symphony is this balance between how it is we encounter service and serving a community, and also making really, really, really great music. In the music world, we often have this toxic hierarchy that those who can't do teach, and those who can't teach do outreach. And that we actually want to undo that hierarchy and kind of lay it on its side to find multiple spaces of expertise and nuance and service and knowledge along that continuum. And so we chose perhaps the most overperformed piece of classical music in existence, Handel's Messiah, the beloved Messiah. And we decided to do a version that perhaps was more fitting for Skid Row. And so what we may not know about Handel's Messiah is that when Handel started writing the piece, he actually had spent about 10 years going broke. He had had a stroke and he was going blind. And he received the text of the Messiah and he wrote in a frenzy, but he couldn't find a venue to present the Messiah in London, so he went to Dublin. And the concerts in Dublin were successful, and so successful that Handel not only paid off all of his debts, but he paid off the debts of 142 men who were facing debtor's prison. And then when the concerts happened in London, they never happened in Handel's life in a concert hall, or even in a court, or a cathedral. They happened in the Foundlings Hospital, the Orphans Hospital. And in the very first performances of Messiah, people from the audience would shout and testify and stand. And in fact, they were so moved, even King George II was so moved that he stood before the Hallelujah chorus, which is why when you go to the Master Chorale sing-along, that I think is happening soon, I think next week or so, you will stand. It's because King George did it. You'll stand before the Hallelujah chorus. But what we often forget in classical music is how so many of the works we love emerged from community. They did not come because a commissioner said, here's a check, give me your greatness. It came because it was inspired by, I have to enter my password again, inspired by the communities that we serve. And so with that, this is Street Symphony's version of the Messiah, which we call the Messiah Project.
Messiah sing-alongs happen all over the place around this time of year,
but there's not one like this. This is the one that matters because we all create it and it connects us.
The Messiah Project is a collaborative event between professional musicians from the LA Master Chorale, the LA Philharmonic, and featuring musicians from the Skid Row community. We present excerpts of Handel's beloved oratorio, The Messiah, along with original works, arranged works, and even new world premiere compositions created by and for the Skid Row community.
This wouldn't be happening if there was no Skid Row.
Gives the people who have been living on Skid Row an opportunity to see the talent and resiliency of the people with whom they live, and it gives those of us who have not had the experience of homelessness to see that we have things to learn from those people.
There's such a huge conversation right now about homelessness, certainly in our city, and it's really easy to start telling everybody how you think things should go, and I think that's what's really important about this moment. We need to listen. Everyone needs to listen, from the people who have experienced Skid Row, who have experienced homelessness.
Physically survive. We need food, we need water, we need shelter, we need clothing. But what speaks to our souls is music.
Whether you're a member of the audience or you're one of the musicians today, we're all here to heal.
When you have been feeling less than, when you've got all kinds of trauma and crisis in your life, to come into a room of joy and to be acknowledged for your voice, it really is a powerful therapeutic tool.
Come on, sing. Do you guys have a voice? Do you have a voice? Are you gonna sing with us? Come on.
on, sing.
We have an assumption about the people in the Skid Row area, and we need to change that dialogue.
Skid Row is not a dumping ground for hospitals, and the psych ward is not a dumping ground for families. It should not be the forgotten neighborhood.
Skid Row is an amazingly rich community of people.
When I say jump, jump, come on, hey!
The greatest gift that we can give another person is our attention. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of Messiah Project. And thank you for listening to us.
Thank you so much, everyone.
I want to acknowledge a street symphony musician who's in the room, Jenny TC, who's a member of your community. He's been part of many Messiah projects. And I just also want to say that we don't do this work alone. You saw so many community partners, the Midnight Mission, Urban Voices Project, Studio 526, the Weingart Center. This work happens with and in community. It doesn't happen with MacArthur geniuses.
Yeah. So. We have so many places we could go with this, and which just means you're going to have to come back. Because I want to give a chance for people out here to engage. We've just got a few minutes left. So questions, thoughts? Just too stunned. Over here. Here, Bob and then Jenny.
My question really relates to the future of Skid Row and whether it's going to be around in 10 years. I mean, that downtown area is changing rapidly. Gentrification, I guess, is the word. And I know there was at time moratoriums on destruction of or conversion of the low-income affordable housing, subsidized housing, really. What's your sense of that?
Skid Row is a community in danger of being erased. And I believe that part of the narrative dialogue change that my colleague Linda was talking about is that we need to shift from seeing Skid Row as a ghetto or a slum or a place of urban blight and more as a recovery zone. I believe Skid Row is the country's largest recovery zone. And in the last 10 years that we've been down in Skid Row, we've seen people fly up from all over the country to get clean in Skid Row because of the concentration of services. It is a complicated, nuanced issue, but also reading about the history of LA from thinkers like Kelly Little Hernandez, who wrote an amazing book called City of Inmates, or a book by Norman Klein called History of Forgetting, Skid Row has been around for over 100 years. And at first was a community for low-income laborers who were working on building Los Angeles. So there is a fear that Skid Row will be erased, but I believe that it's actually up to us and, you know, so many of our leaders to work with developers and covenant in the fact that we need permanent supportive housing. And the fact that is that we're not talking under the bond of H or HHH about nearly enough of the housing that we need. We actually need far more than 500,000 units of housing now in order to fix this issue. So yeah, it's an incredibly complicated issue and very sad one.
I just love you, and I think you're just one of the most amazing human beings that I have ever met in my entire life. And I don't know anybody like you. I truly don't. What I wanna know is there ever a thought in Street Symphony's mind to add a youth component to this, where our youth can know about the Skid Row community and participate in some kind of musical event with Street Symphony?
So we have entered into conversations with Juvenile Hall over the last several years, Los Padrinos, and a number of other agencies which work with youth. But as you may know, there's actually an injunction to youth services in the presence of youth in Skid Row. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that there are individuals who are recovering or living in Skid Row who might have a record which doesn't allow them to be around children, and so there's around minors per se. So there is actually this kind of disconnect with continuing to serve Skid Row and then serving youth throughout the county, but that what we would like to do is actually, and not only with youth in LA, but create a model of engagement that then can be taken up by organizations that want to serve youth. I mean, there's so many homeless youth in Hollywood, for example, at Safe Space for Youth or at My Friend's Place or that kind of thing. So it is certainly on our minds, for sure, yeah.
Yes, that, and I mean, youth music organizations, mm-hmm.
Ah, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, likewise, it's actually not often that youth groups can come in to even volunteer if they're under 18 to come to Skid Row. But I work very closely with my students at the Colburn School to actually, there's a large emerging artist component to street symphony where students are spending time learning about street symphony projects, and then when they go off into their professional lives, realizing that this is not something that they do in response to being a professional musician, but rather as being a whole person and whole artist. So the youth cultivation piece of how we do what we do is certainly front and center. Yeah, thank you, Jenny.
Over here. Yes.
Yeah. We'll take one back there and then we'll
come. I'd like to point out that the conductor on the street symphony is Zenaida Robles,
right,
who composed the piece that the choir is singing this morning.
Is that right? How fitting is that?
Right.
There's a question.
So here.
When is the next Street Symphony Messiah, and how does one get to participate?
So Street Symphony's Messiah is actually this week. That's why it's a busy week for me. But we have actually grappled with how we open this event to the public, because the truth is it's not open to the public. And the reason for that is because we do in-person canvassing this entire week in Skid Row to make it assured to the Skid Row community that this event is for them and about them. However, there are many events through 2020. I mean, the fourth Thursday of every month is a street symphony event at the Midnight Mission, and you are more than welcome to attend, and you are more than welcome to volunteer with the meal service that happens right before the street symphony event. And so what we've been thinking about is how it is that we can incorporate people like you who care and want to get involved and want to show up and have the balance to really celebrate this community and not replace them in their own event.
Mm-hmm. Is all this online?
It is all online, yes.
Yeah. We have one more over here.
Please.
So Vijay, thank you very much for a very rich presentation. I want to return to something that Mike started with at the beginning, especially here in Los Angeles, where real estate and homes are looked upon primarily as an economic asset. Mm. And what your work is to build community and moving people away from economic values to more human and humane values. Mm. So I wonder whether in the Street Symphony and in your broader work, whether you've tried to engage that crucial problem, because still people get the idea that home is something that is actually comes from the word humus, which means ground, and is a community concept. Mm. Unless people move away from that economic value to this human value, we still wouldn't have tackled the sort of structural problem at the heart of homelessness.
Certainly, and you know, one, I think so much of the shift that can happen is in the language we use, right? To describe homelessness not as, that is a homeless person, but a person experiencing homelessness, that it is a condition that is temporary, but that people who experience homelessness might be houseless, but they are not placeless. And that is an important distinction for us to drive home, quite literally, because I think in the economic versus human exchange, there is, in both arenas, the myth of scarcity. The myth of scarcity, that we need to enter into the space of abundance. And what we hope to communicate in the work of Street Symphony is that in being kind, not only do we not lose something, we gain. That we need to remind ourselves to take the permission to be kind, to be generous, to be caring for our neighbors, not from a place of saying, I've done enough for you and now my work is done, but to say that you are my neighbor and I am here with you. And to create it from that place of human abundance as we move forward.
So I understand you want to close us with an experience.
I'd love to. Yes, please.
Let's hear your hallelujah.